energy healing practitioner, Amber Kurtz, and I wanted to give you a little intro before you listen to the interview with David Chance. Basically, I wanted to try to narrow down a little bit of what happened step by step with the food process, that sort of thing, the diet change, that sort of thing. Yes, first the process, the beginning process was getting him home from the hospital from a mass heart attack. There was that. And then I spent about a week and a half, and then off and on about 2 weeks there taking care of him. Very, very intensely the first week, though. And part of that process was getting out the house of all the bad food, so it wasn't tempting, and to be able to refill everything with good food, right? I had lots of high sodium foods in the house, canned foods. I won't go there too far because it was scary. And also he was not eating organic, that sort of thing. So I spent a lot of my time gutting out the house of all nasty foods and then replacing them, bringing stuff from my garden, and preparing things and putting them in the freezer, that sort of thing, so that when he wasn't feeling well, he didn't have to, like, you know, slide back and go, oh, well, I didn't have anything, I was really tired, I wasn't feeling good. You know, there was always something there. So that was a big part of the process. As far as foods go, we went to vegan, obviously. When he started cooking for himself, he kind of went back to his normal thing that he was comfortable with, which was a lot of cooked foods, a lot of tofu. He wasn't ever eating enough greens in his diet, dark greens, that sort of thing. But that was okay because he was still healing, he was still doing way better than he was before. So then we slowly moved him into, you know, using more legumes and nuts and things like that in his diet, and trying to work in more of the dark leafy greens. Also, a lot of diabetics quite often will go straight to a lot of fruit, thinking that that's a lot healthier, and it is healthier, obviously, and for a normal person that's fine, but a lot of times what a lot of diabetics will do is they'll go straight for the sweetest fruit they can possibly find, the sweetest juice, you know, and also very purposely not read the back to see if it has high fructose corn syrup added to it. So just working on all those little things. Let's see, so right now he's eating a really large quantity of raw foods. He's learning how to sprout, and he's also dabbling in the fermentation process. We're not very far into that process yet, but we're getting there. Because he really was lacking nutrient-dense foods, you know. We talked a lot about bread, which you'll listen to. He was a lot of bread, a lot of heavy creams, cheese, kind of a vegetarian. So lacking nutrients, like most of Americans. But this was a large part of the healing process. You know, we do definitely touch on yoga very well in this. That was a gigantic part of his healing process, gigantic. Pulling his mental space back together and pulling his body and all that back together has been absolutely phenomenal. And there's always different kinds of yoga. I wanted to mention that, different kinds of yoga. And you know, you start out with a nice gentle yoga, you can move into some other yogas, but you never want to forget your yin yoga. Yin yoga is amazing. And there's other names for different types of yoga that are gentle too. And those are very, very important, no matter how progressed you are in your health process. Let's see. I felt like I wanted to touch on something else. Ah, yes. If you're looking at actually doing this, you're actually going to wean yourself off of the medical industry, the pharmaceutical industry. You know, they're like this big, they're gigantic. And what we want is this big. We want a medical industry that's this big. We want them to be able to do invasive type surgeries when necessary. We want them to do trauma type things. But what we don't want is for them to continue to say things like managing diabetes, okay? Type 2 diabetes doesn't have to exist. We created it through our eating habits. We can get rid of it through our eating habits. So, you know, and right now the dialysis is growing out of control. The medical industry is still growing, and it's because we don't understand what health is. The medical industry is not health. Medical doctors are not trained to help you be healthy. What they do is they're trained to diagnose symptoms, prescribe medications, and prescribe invasive type surgeries, which sometimes are necessary. But that's what they do. And what we need to realize is that health starts at home. You know, health starts at your herbalist, health starts at your naturopath and your energy healer, and on that goes. So this is where we're going, hopefully, with a certain amount of the society. Not everybody's capable of understanding the body-mind-spirit concept, sadly, or doing it, but I have a feeling that there's a lot of you out there that just didn't realize it was there for you. You didn't realize there was another option. And if you're ready to take accountability for yourself and start taking care of yourself instead of allowing somebody else to take care of you, allowing somebody else to lie to you, corporations, that sort of thing, about what's good for you food-wise and that sort of thing, then you're ready to start making some steps forward to your health. So I guess that's all I need to say right now, although I always want to keep talking. So I'm just going to stop. I hope you enjoy the interview. I hope it helps. I hope it gives you some support. And we'll go from there. All right. Enjoy. Bye-bye. For now. Hello. My name's Amber. I'm an energy healing practitioner. And this is David Chance. He went through a really serious heart attack. And it really started his evolution of healing from type 2 diabetes and also from the heart attack. It was just a catalyst of movement to kind of help him realize that he didn't feel good and he wanted to live and he wanted to feel good while living. So we're just going to have a chit-chat and see what that process was. It was body, mind, and spirit is how he moved through this process. Although he didn't know that when it started. It just become that or became that as he moved on through the process. So, hi.
Hi.
What do you want to start with? Like, do you want to start with, I don't know, maybe because you were healthy, fairly healthy before, mm-hmm. And then about, and obviously before 2007 when you were diagnosed, you started falling down. So, do you want to kind of start where you were kind of healthy, what you're doing, and then kind of from there?
Or? Well, I had always been very healthy throughout my life, very seldom sick or anything like that. Lots of energy, things like that. And I guess when it started changing was about around 2002 or so, which is when I turned 50. And I didn't really, I mean, I noticed it at the time, but I didn't realize the ramifications of it. I just thought, oh, I'm older now, and when you're older, you don't feel as well. And it took me a few years until I began to realize that I might have diabetes. I started to suspect that I had diabetes probably at around 2005, when I had a treatment for another medical condition that made the diabetes flare up. And at the time, the physician thought, well, that's just a reaction to the medication and I wouldn't worry about it. But in 2007, which is about the time that...
do you mind if I ask
yes.
What the treatment was for that particular thing?
It was prednisone. I had a condition at the time, which there's now doubt. In fact, I'm pretty sure I've never had it to start with, but a condition of ulcerative colitis. Mm-hmm. And I went through a period one day of really intense cramps, and not my physician, but my GI physician put me on prednisone. Mm-hmm. One of the effects of prednisone is that it can, if you're a latent diabetic, it can cause it to suddenly...
It has lots and lots of side effects.
Yes. And so, consequently, I'm on a trip to Florida, and we're stopping every 10 minutes so I can go to the bathroom. Mm-hmm. So I recognize those signs, being in the medical field myself, and so that was when I began to suspect that I had diabetes. My physician said, oh, it'll go away. It's no problem. It's just a reaction to the medication. Mm-hmm. But about 2 years later, when I moved out to Oregon, that's when it became obvious that I did have diabetes. So that would have been around 2007, mm-hmm. probably late 2007.
That's when you were diagnosed, though, right?
Yes.
By a medical doctor.
By a medical doctor, yes. I actually had confirmatory of a lab test before I saw the medical doctor, but mm-hmm. yes, that's when it was diagnosed. Okay. So, as I said, when I, in around 2002, I just started feeling not as good, not as much energy.
So can I ask you another question?
Sure.
I'll just keep saying, can I ask you another question? That's going to be...
What if I say no?
I'll say, okay, you asked me a question. I'll go from there.
No, that's fine. Go ahead. Sorry.
So, he has a terrible sense of humor. It's not funny, I know. So I'm not laughing. I guess, because I don't want to go too far ahead before going backwards a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
You said you were always seemed to be a healthy person. You didn't seem to get sick very often. But did you notice that you changed your habits somewhere where you got sick? Or did you just feel really good until you got sick?
Actually, I didn't notice it at the time. Mm-hmm. But going back and looking... when I started feeling bad was also about the time that I started backsliding a little bit from a vegan vegetarian diet.
Mm-hmm.
And like I said, I didn't notice at the time. Little things like, eating cheese or eating more prepared food and junk foods mm-hmm. and stuff like that. And looking back on it, I can tie it down to almost exactly that time is when I started feeling worse, and can also track it back to that's when the diabetes really started flaring up.
Right. Okay, and so I guess we're going to fast forward a little bit again, since we kind of went backwards, we're going forwards again. So we're looking at you now, obviously knowing you definitely have type 2 diabetes. What did you do? Like, how did you handle that?
I definitely handled it like most diabetics probably do. I ignored it.
Mm-hmm.
I continued to eat the way I did.
Your prescribed medications, and you took your medications?
Until 2007, I wasn't on medication, and then they put me on some pills.
Right, when you were actually diagnosed.
Yeah, when I was actually diagnosed. for a while, and this seems to be kind of a... theme with me, for a while the medications worked
mm-hmm.
quite well, and my laboratory tests were all within normal parameters, but as healing people all know, the cure to diabetes is not medication, and so it may work for a little while, but if you don't change your habits, it's not going to work forever. So then I started having problems again, and at this point in time, none of my problems were really severe problems. Other than the heart attack that I had last August.
Other than that little thing, which
may or may not have been related to the diabetes, probably was. But other than that, I have.
It was related
had,
to your eating habits,
yeah,
obviously.
Exactly. Yeah.
Which is related to diabetes, which is all related to everything, right?
Right.
Or not? Are you going to argue with that one?
Nope.
I didn't think so. So we got that one out of the way. All right. Moving on.
Pretty much ignored it, continued my eating habits the way that they were, trusting that the medication was going to take care of it, and obviously that didn't happen. In 2011, I ended up in the hospital with some kind of GI tract problem that they never did diagnose, never did come to a conclusion on. I was in the hospital for 8 days. And during that time, one of the first things that they noticed when I got in the hospital was how high my glucose was and the other parameters that they measure diabetes with. So they started me on insulin in the hospital to try to get that under control. And it was bad enough that it took about 3 days of intravenous insulin before it got down to normal. Mm-hmm. And so I was in the hospital for 8 days. When I finally got out, I made the decision to continue on insulin. I thought it was working well, and...
What were you taking before? Because you were taking prescriptions, but what were
yes,
you taking
before? Before I was taking, it was in my mind until you asked that.
Oh, of course.
Well, the second
and of course
one,
it's a strange name.
Metformin was the first thing that I was on, and then eventually they had me on both metformin and Januvia.
Okay.
So they moved me to insulin in the hospital. I elected to stay on that when I got out for some obvious reasons, but I'll state them anyway. It still allowed me to eat the way I wanted to eat,
mm-hmm.
Because you just give yourself a bigger dose of insulin.
Mm-hmm.
You know? I had lost about 15 or 20 pounds when I was in the hospital, so... one of the things that... physicians are notorious for not telling you everything. And one of the things that they didn't tell me when I was in the hospital is that one of the side effects of insulin is weight gain.
Mm-hmm.
So here I am out of the hospital, took about a month to recuperate, and thought this was wonderful because my glucose was fine and my A1C, which is a long-term measure of glucose, was fine. And so, I had control of this, right? And, of course, I didn't notice until I gained about 20 pounds that, I was way above the weight that I was when I went into the hospital. And so now I was an overweight diabetic. I think at the high point of my weight gain, I probably weighed about 209 pounds.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas before... I started on insulin and started having problems. I generally weighed around 175. So it's about, 35-pound weight gain.
I'm going to interrupt just a tiny bit if you can keep your thought process.
Mm-hmm.
I just want to point out to a lot of people that obesity is a gigantic problem in the U.S., but just because you're exercising does not mean you can eat whatever you want, because you'll end up a not too overweight, not too obese diabetic is what's going to happen. A lot of people don't put two and two together or think about like that. They're like, oh, they look okay. Oh, but they eat whatever they want. It's like, it will catch up to you in one point or another. And the bottom line, it's always catching up to you. But we tend to, when things gradually move from one place to another, as we gradually get sick, we just ignore it. And then all of a sudden, oh, I'm sick. It's like, oh, yeah, but it wasn't a big kaboom. You didn't just get in a car accident. This was a process that was happening. So I just wanted to kind of throw that out in the air. Hello, Dave.
Hello. And while you're actually on that subject, I will say that, that was part of my problem, both with managing the diabetes and with having a heart attack, is absolutely no exercise whatsoever. I mean, for probably 20 years before that, I never exercised. I mean, the only exercise I got was walking in from the parking lot at work, and
mm-hmm.
not even walking up the stairs, because a lot of times I took the elevator and things like that. So not only did I have a horrible diet and all of that, but I was not doing anything to provide my body with any type of exercise.
Okay. I know we skipped from what you were talking about before, but this is a conversation,
mm-hmm.
so it works.
Yeah.
I always, when you talk about body, mind, and spirit, mind is a very connected to emotion.
Mm-hmm.
And so how are your emotions during this process? What was going on? And I know that's a big question because everything started from here to there, but
mm-hmm.
there must have been an emotional space too where you're still ignoring this.
I was still ignoring it, and I was also, I guess I would say, in a very poor emotional state. I was... basically at the point where I just didn't care. What I cared about was food, eating things that tasted good. And of course, a lot of those things are addictive, so the more you eat them, the better they taste.
Mm-hmm.
And so I was basically eating myself to death, and with no exercise on top of it. I was not maintaining my glucose well. Insulin maintains your glucose well, but you have to remember to take it. Mm-hmm. And I was also very bad at that. I would eat and 4 hours later realize, oh, I forgot to take my insulin. Mm-hmm. And I tie all that back to, I just didn't care anymore. Mm-hmm. I mean, I wasn't actively or knowingly trying to kill myself, but that's basically what was happening.
Right.
Is that I was killing myself and I really didn't care. I won't go into details, but I didn't have a lot in my life to live for as far as I was concerned.
As far as you knew.
Yeah, as far as I knew, as far as my life at that point was concerned. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I have in the past laughed at people who made this comment, but I found myself in the same condition of, oh, well, so I'm smoking myself to death or so I'm eating myself to death. I'm going to enjoy myself, and who cares if I die 10 years earlier than when I would have anyway. Mm-hmm. You know, and I always knew how ridiculous that was, but that's exactly what I was doing. So, yes, there was a very strong emotional content. I just really didn't care if I died tomorrow or not.
As you thought you were enjoying yourself in the meantime.
Yeah, and I will say, you know, and this is important so that people don't fall into this trap. It's not like I sat down and said that to myself.
Of course not.
I didn't say, oh, I really don't care if I die tomorrow, mm-hmm. or I'm eating myself to death, but I don't really care. Like everything else with diabetes and bad living, it sneaks up on you. Mm-hmm.
That makes sense. And, I mean, if you ask pretty much anyone, almost everyone, nobody says, I don't love myself. They say, oh, I love myself. They also say, I know how to eat right. I'm eating well. These are usually the lies we tell to ourselves so we get by with what we're doing. And it just happens to almost all of us.
You know, another thing that was very big with me to warn people about, okay, so one day you're hungry and you have a bad bag of potato chips or whatever, and you say, I'll go back on the diet tomorrow.
All right, it's always tomorrow.
And don't ever believe that. I've played that game so many times. Tomorrow never comes, because tomorrow you say, well, okay, I blew it yesterday, but I'm blowing it now, but I can start tomorrow. And tomorrow never comes. Mm-hmm. You know, you just stay that way. You either make a commitment and you do it, or you don't.
I'll have to revise that a little bit, because you're right. You know, you make a commitment, you do it or you don't. But you have to understand, too, that sometimes you're going to backslide a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
But just don't give yourself that, it's okay, I did that. Go, okay, I did that. I'm going to own up to it. I'm going to own this. Mm-hmm. And now I'm going to go back to what I did. And so if you own what you do and you're not lying to yourself anymore about, oh, I'll do this later or whatever, mm-hmm. you're actually owning what you did and you're not lying to yourself, that makes a big progress in your life. So that's a biggie. So we just got through a lot of like back history of what's going on with David's life. And now we're going to move on to the heart attack sequence. But what we're really trying to convey here is that things don't just sneak up on you. You know, the eating habits, the type 2 diabetes, those are habits that are formed, and they create issues in your health, you know, your actual health. So we got type 2 diabetes now diagnosed. Obviously, there's other issues. And I've known David for a really long time, actually, not really close known him, but I've known him for many years. And so we also have skin conditions. You know, he looked terrible. He smelled bad. Although I have a pretty high biliary factory issue going on. But I think that all of these issues go forward, and most of the time we just ignore them. Other people around you ignore them, especially when it's just like, go to a doctor, get a medication. Go to a doctor, get a medication, and just keep doing whatever you're doing. Because we don't want anyone to feel bad, right? Don't feel bad, just love yourself. Well, loving yourself actually means action, and none of this has been happening, so we're just going on a downhill scale right now. David's not doing well. I've gently said gentle things to him, but those are ignored. And again, we're not really good friends. We're just, you know, we know each other. We like each other. And now we're sloping into, or we're not sloping, we're climbing a mountain, and then we're going to fall off a cliff. And that's when the heart attack happens. And David, you can probably go from there.
Okay. So, you know, just to give a little bit more background, so here I am, you know, a type 2 diabetic that is not doing well, diabetes is not controlled well, gaining weight, and then comes August 15th, 2014, when I ended up in the emergency room with what turned out to be a heart attack. So, while I was laying in the emergency room, waiting for them to do things with me, I started texting different people that I knew to let them know what was going on, and of course texting work to tell them I'm not going to be in that day. And I texted Amber, and then she texted back, and eventually I got transferred to the Good Samaritan in Corvallis, and where I was immediately taken in for a to the cardiac cath room and had two stents put into one of my arteries. So I got back to the room, ended up going back again for a brief period of time, and finally, you know, the next day I'm somewhat recovering, and I texted Amber again, let her know what was going on. And she texted me back and said, this was on Friday, and said she would be down Sunday to see me. And a little while later, and you have to remember that when you're in the hospital and had a heart attack, your memory is really garbage. So much of this is compressed in my mind. I don't know what the actual time period was, but she did text me back a little bit later and say that she had cleared her calendar for that week and that she would come pick me up, take me home, and that she would stay with me for a week to do all the things that I didn't at this point know that I wasn't going to be able to do for myself.
Right. I'll be fine.
I had no idea, even though I'm in the medical field, I had no idea at this point how weak and tired I was going to be when I got home, and how there were almost everything I was not going to be able to do for myself. So at this point, you know, it's also interesting to note that I really didn't know what Amber did for a living. She did tell me when she texted me back that she did, as part of her job, if you want to call it that, she did transition people from the hospital back to home. So I knew that part of it. And she also texted me back and said she would take me home, she would take care of me for a week. But I had to obey her.
I did. I said that.
Yes.
You need to obey me.
I can show you the text.
We might have to.
No, she Amber is very blunt. She doesn't believe in playing games. Mm-hmm. And she very definitely said, you have to obey me. And at that point, I wasn't really sure what that meant, because I didn't know at that point that she was an energy healer. Now, I'm sure she had told me numerous times, because like she said, we've known each other for a long time. Not, I mean, good friends, not close friends, but, you know. And so I really didn't know what that meant, if I even knew it at that point, even remembered it.
Right. I did text him at least, though, and said, but, and you will be on a vegan diet.
Right.
And thankfully, one of his younger doctors on the cardiac team, which I think helped him, because he's so much at this point, he has no idea about energy work. I mean, he's asked me a couple times, and I say, well, I'm an energy healer. And he's like, well, what's that? And I'll explain a little bit. And, like, and then it just like goes away. It's like, I don't get any of this. I don't understand. Like, I don't care, you know, that's why we're just, you know, good friends. Anyway, so the younger doctor actually did say, it's like, you know, after heart attack, a vegan diet is really, really good. And there's a PhD, whatever, PhD somewhere, some doctor somewhere, that also, you know, says this is the best way to recover from, you know, a massive heart attack. And so I think that was really helpful because of where his mindset was. And then him just knowing me and going, okay, you know, I like Amber. I know she can take care of me, you know. A trust, he definitely was a trust thing there. So that's kind of how I felt about it, because it seemed like everything kind of went in a row good enough to for this to happen.
Yeah. So we get home, and you know, on the way home, we stop at a grocery store, and Amber picks up some stuff that I'm going to eat. And so we get home, and you know, I, of course, go to bed because I'm so weak that,
exhausted.
You know, I'm having a hard time walking in the door. And so it wasn't until, well, I don't know, maybe the first day, second day, whatever, that, you know, we started talking about getting to work. And I will be real honest here, and I don't know if I've told you this ever, but when she started talking about energy work and everything, I went, oh, crap. Because I still have a brother, but I had a brother many years ago that, although...
Not sure where I hid the body.
I got a big backyard. It's under one of those raised beds. I'll show you those later. All right, the FBI will get a hold of us later. Anyway, so although my brother was not an energy healer, he was into some similar type stuff, and, you know, I never had much respect for it and used to kind of make fun of him about it and stuff like that. So I'm going, oh, no, what is this? But an interesting thing happened twice, I think maybe three times, and let me do a real short segue here. You know, when you're a really bad diabetic and then you have a heart attack, your memory really goes to crap. And so there's a lot of things that I don't remember, things that people told me that I said and did that I have no memory of.
Mm-hmm. Before and after, because it's this, again, it's a process before you get there for the most part.
Right.
You know, all the chemicals they use during surgery. I've never been around anyone who's went through even, you know, a nice scheduled surgery, you know, for something fairly minor, that hasn't come out with some sort of issues before their mind kind of starts coming to be, like the long term. I'm stuttering, sorry. I might have just came out of surgery.
This is where we pause.
So the long-term memory is always, almost always there. Even in dementia, the long-term is usually there. But the short-term just gets really awful. So not only do we have type 2 diabetes, we're not feeling good, and then we go through surgery with a massive heart attack, and then, yeah, memories are not very good. Just self-care is not very good. So when you're transitioning somebody back home from any sort of surgery, you have to remember that. You know, I was also thinking that I'd have to take care of David's medications really well and make sure that he was on those. But for some reason, it must have been such a long-term memory thing that he had his medications down, even the new ones that he was on, he had them down. I'd check him anyway to make sure, but that was one thing I was kind of grateful for. It's like, wow, at least I don't have to take care of the medication part. You had that one down to a T.
One. So, anyway, the reason I bring that up is I just don't want people to think that, you know, we haven't researched this video or don't know what we're talking about. There's a lot of empty places in my memory that I have no memory of. So anyway, we're starting to talk about energy healing and things like that, and I'm going, oh Lord. And, but there's a couple interesting things, two or three, depending on whether you believe me or Amber, believe Amber. That happened that really turned it around and made a believer of me. Two of them, well, one of them was I woke up in the middle of the night and I was gasping for breath. And not chest pains, but just gasping for breath. And later Amber told me that she wasn't real sure she wasn't going to have to call 911. Mm-hmm. But anyway, I was not doing well. And Amber, you know, heard me up and everything and came to my rescue. And she, as I remember, she put, you know, one hand on my chest and one hand on my head or something like that. And she said, I'm going to use some energy healing on you. And within seconds, it was gone. It was one of the most remarkable things that I have ever seen. So that kind of, that, not kind of, that made a believer out of me. And then there was another instance, maybe the next night, I'm not sure exactly when, again, that lousy memory, that wasn't as severe, it wasn't as potentially life-threatening, but it was, again, you know, a pain that I had somewhere that was very discomforting and also very worrisome because I was afraid that it meant that I was having another heart attack or some complications of it or something like that. And she once again did the same thing. She had me close my eyes and she put her hands on the affected area and she did her energy healing and immediately it was gone. And I'm not sure what the third time was because I don't have a memory of it.
Well, I'm not sure there was a third time.
Oh, okay.
No, there was a third time, but it was much more minimal. That I actually worked on you, but I was always working on you in general.
Mm-hmm.
And we did do some herbals right when you got home. I don't know if you remember that, but I'd always say, make sure that take this. But this, at least the second time that I did the energy work on you that you do remember, but you don't remember exactly what it was, you felt like something was grasping your leg.
Right.
And it was very painful, which could have been a blood clot.
And that was my concern, because being in the medical industry and also have most of my career being in blood clot type things, that's what I was concerned about, is that I was having a, you know, deep vein thrombosis in my leg or something like that.
So again, if I was an MD, I could just diagnose it, but I'm not and I don't want to.
Yeah.
But
so that is what I like to call one trial learning. With those two instances, yes, I realize that's two, not one, but I became a believer. It's really difficult not to believe in something like this, and maybe I shouldn't say believe, maybe I should say no, but you know, you're forced to understand it and understand that it's true because you experience it. And you know, a lot of people may say, oh, it was in your mind, but I was there and it wasn't in my mind.
Right, and if it happens more than once, you're like, oh, wait a minute, this didn't just happen once, it wasn't just some sort of, you know, fluke. So then you start realizing how things work. And this was David's, like, kind of turning point, even though memory was not still back, but he trusted me, and then he started trusting what I do. And besides just the human care I could give him, he realized the spiritual, energetic care that I could give him. And then he started doing it himself. You know, really, he did.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so he started doing the diet the way he needed to. And we did incremental diet changes because, you know, he's still stubborn. And so, right? Are you still stubborn?
I am not.
But no, I'm just kidding. He's amazing. He started making tons of changes. Yeah, a little tiny bit of hesitation here and there, but he did them. He started seeing the benefits of the diet changes. The herbals did not last very long. He only needed them for a while. He started shedding off the medications, and we'll talk about how many medications he was on at that point that he shed it off. You know, blood pressure, rate, heart rate, all that sort of thing. But the bottom line is he consistently believed that if he made changes in his life that he would get better, and he has. So let's go back to how many medications you were on before the heart attack.
Okay, before the heart attack, I was on two and sometimes three medications. I was on Novolog, which is a fast-acting insulin. I was on Lantus, which is a slow-acting insulin that you take at night to kind of simulate the action of your pancreas and get you through the night without your glucose going up. And then I was on one of two medications, either Byetta or Victoza. You don't take them together, but I was on one or the other at any particular time. So those are what I was on before, and basically when I and I should correct that. The Byetta I started having nausea problems with, so I stopped taking it, and that was part of the reason for the weight gain, because Byetta can keep you from gaining weight when you're still eating the garbage that you're not supposed to be eating. So I switched to Victoza. That really didn't do anything, so I don't remember exactly if I was still on Victoza when I had the heart attack, but around that time.
Right, that's fine. Approximately.
So now we have post-heart attack. So I was on a blood pressure medicine. Actually, I was on two blood pressure medicines. One was metoprolol, which controls your blood pressure and also supposedly strengthens your heart, makes it beat harder, so it basically strengthens your heart. I was on lisinopril, which is supposed to help your kidneys from keeping working too hard, so protect them, and also is a blood pressure medicine. I was on clopidogrel, which is another name for Plavix, which is a platelet inhibitor, because platelets collecting up against your vessel wall is part of what causes the plaques that cause your closing of your arteries, or at least that's the medical idea of how it works. I was on aspirin. I was on Lasix for probably a couple weeks when I got out of the hospital, and then that was discontinued. And I think that's it.
Okay. Is that it?
Yeah.
That was a lot.
I'll be fine. So, and some of them, you know, physicians sometimes kind of worry about things that in reality may not need to be worried about. For instance, one of the reasons why I was on the metoprolol was because they felt that my heart rate was too rapid. It was around 90 to 100. The thing that they didn't take into account is my heart rate has always been between 90 and 100, even when I was a small boy. That's normal for me. So, you know, they wanted to reduce that heart rate. So, anyway, so those were the medications I was on. I was on those for maybe 2 months. I don't know the exact amount of time. And then, you know, Amber and I, in conversation, we kind of mutually decided that I don't really need to be on those. Mm-hmm. You know, my feeling was that those are things that people need to be on if they're not going to change their life, if they're going to continue to eat the garbage they're eating and not have any exercise. And by the way, at this point in time, I was in cardiac rehab 3 days mm-hmm. a week, exercising, and also exercising the other days on my own.
Still on a vegan diet?
Still on a vegan diet. So, you know, my feeling was that really, with the changes in my lifestyle, I probably didn't need to be on those
right.
anymore.
And at this point, you were working with your guides.
Right.
And so that's always the backup. It's like, okay, what do my guides say about what's actually going on with my body, and how can I slowly transition off of these? And usually it's a slow transition. You know, you start taking less of something, or you cut one out and just stay on a few, see how you're doing, and then slowly cut them out. Now, of course, you're supposed to do this under your doctor's regulation, but you are your own person, and if you're working with your guides and it's your choice and you want to do this, this is how you get off medication instead of being attached to a pharmaceutical company all the time. That's how it works.
And that was one of the things that, you know, again, at this point in time, I was very into the guides and energy healing and all that. I didn't really need to have anything proved to me anymore. But that was one of the things that I thought worked well with it, is that when I consulted the guides, they didn't say, oh, just go off everything at once. They said, do this and then do that. And, you know, they said, taper it down. You know, it wasn't just, and the reason why I make that point is because, you know, people might criticize and say, oh, that was all in your mind and you just decided that. But if it were all in my mind, I would have just quit taking them all at once. So, you know, your guides are always concerned about you. They, you know, want your health to be good. They don't want anybody on medication because they realize it's not good for you, but they also realize that there are times when if you're on medication, you can't just stop taking it tomorrow. You have to taper it off. And so we did that. So currently, I am on none of those medications. I have also stopped taking the Lantus, the long-lasting insulin. I am still on the fast-acting insulin. I have not stopped taking that completely yet, but I am taking vastly less than what I was taking at the height of time, say right before the heart attack or immediately after. I was probably taking 30 to 40 units a day. Now there are days when I take none, and most days I don't take more than about 5 to 7 units.
Which is an amazing difference.
Pretty big difference. And as we go along, I will realize, I kind of realize this intellectually, but it has to become part of you, is that even that 5 to 7 I probably don't need to take. It's just that, you know, because my pancreas isn't back to where it should be when you eat, your glucose goes high, and I'm still somewhat in the scientific frame of mind of, oh, my glucose is high, so I have to take some insulin to bring it back down. These are things that we're working on.
Yeah, and that's important because you learning to trust your guys, obviously they've done a lot for him, is a big deal, is learning how to trust them. But then you also have to find your comfort zone of what you're going to do. And you also have to understand that his body hasn't worked for years. His body has not had to work. It's never done its job for years. And so now it's slowly starting to learn how to do its job again. And so you have to be gentle through that process of learning, for it learning how to do its job again. That's why it's body, mind, spirit, you know, how we mind over matter, and then we have our mind creating all the chemicals in our body and talking to every little organ in our body and how it creates who we are. Hello, hi, I'm Amber, this is David, this is who I am. But all of these things go on within us at all times, and if we start shutting down our systems through various different ways, we can do that, not just food, then it just stops working. So we have to kind of wake it up, say, hey, I'm back, I'm ready, if you're ready. And then we just kind of perk it back up, and it's starting to work, obviously. And we have to go from there.
Yeah, well, I mean, one of the things, and I might be jumping a little ahead here, but you know, one of the things that I notice now, in about 2 weeks, I'm going to have my 1-year anniversary of the heart attack, and I feel so much better. And not only do I feel better, but my memory is better. I mean, if you can imagine this, driving in a car to a store, the store has 2 entrances. You walk into the store, you pick up what you need, you check out, and you can't remember which entrance you came in or where your car is parked. That's bad memory. Now, I will say that I have always been directionally challenged. So some of that is probably never going to go away of not knowing how to get somewhere or something like that. But I should, you know, even in those times, you should have been able to remember where you parked your car. And that has been going away. Today, I can walk into a store with 2 entrances, and I remember which entrance I walked in. I remember where my car is. There are a lot of things that are better now than what they were. Memory, and my memory is still getting better.
It is.
It's not at the point where it's perfect yet.
Mine's not.
But it's much better. Maybe we should do some energy healing.
Yeah, maybe we should work on me a little.
Strength-wise, you know, we're going to talk later about, you know, some changes I've made in the house and the grounds here and things like that. But let's just suffice to say that the 40-pound bags of soil that I was using to set up some raised beds, I could hardly carry when we first started that. Today, I picked one up and carried it all across the yard, and I wasn't short of breath. It wasn't hard to carry. It's the same bag as before, same company, same weight, everything. And I carried it without any trouble. So, you know, all of these things are, first of all, a better functioning body because you're taking better care of it. And also just due to exercise and some weight training and things like that. So
yeah, this is a good point to start talking about right now, is that, you know, we can talk about diagnosis all the time, but the bottom line is David had a whole bunch of issues, just like you, if you have issues and you're listening to this right now, have a whole lot of issues that aren't diagnosable. It's like, oh, I feel achy here, I feel a little weak. And then, so that's the sick part, right? And then we get into the healthier, growing part, like, oh, I'm going to like start creating this whole body, mind, spirit idea, and I'm going to start progressing. So David's process was, one, getting out of the hospital, getting home, right? After the stents that had to be put in and all that, we changed diet, right? And I was there like step by step for a lot of that, but then, and he went to the cardio, the basic, you know, cardio rehab that they have. And as soon as he got through all that, and if you're an energy healer, please pay attention. Like, all of this is step by step by step. So after we got through that process, and he's making gradual steps all the time, then it's time for him to go to yoga. What I try to do is, which we all should try to do, is create this network of people that you can reach out to that are good holistic people that you can start creating a family of, basically. A support system for a healthy lifestyle instead of a sick lifestyle. And so the healthy lifestyle is, okay, it's time for you to go to yoga. Now that took a little bit of work, but we got there. And then you need a massage therapist, you need to do self-care, and then you need to do this. And then this way, he doesn't feel alone, although when you're working with your guides, you feel more complete with that. And then, of course, he has me, but then he's still back. All of his friends and what he normally does is sick. You know, it's just the medical system, which is good for some things. It's good for fixing things right now. Like when he had a heart attack, he needed the stents put in, right? Sad he ever got to that point, but that's what needed to happen at the time it needed to happen. But what he needed to do is create a cushion zone of better people to be around. So he didn't feel alone. And so he felt like he knew that when he was doing the right thing and that he could share that with other people and be part of that. So that's kind of where we have to go to.
And what she's saying is very important, because if you're going to fight this battle alone, you're going to lose.
Mm-hmm.
You know, obviously, I lost before. You know, and just to give an example, for instance, for me, the big thing is, the barometer that I use on how I'm doing is bread. I love bread. I can't tell you the last
time. The soft, fluffy bread.
You're right. I can't
and cheese.
I can't
Don't
tell you
cheese.
The last time that I've had a piece of bread. To me, and if there is a time that I've had it that I just don't remember, I had it once and that was it. I don't eat bread anymore because I know that's my weakness. I know if I go out to a restaurant and they bring a big basket of bread and I eat one piece, I will devour the whole basket and probably eat the basket too. It's just something I can't do. It's kind of like being an alcoholic, you know, you can't take a drink.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a lot of things like that to know what your weakness is and that's not my only weakness, but that's a barometer I use. If I can stay away from bread, then there's a lot of things I can do.
Mm-hmm.
You know, interestingly enough, a lot of my friends, I don't know if I'd say friends, but at least people I work with, have been very supportive on this and actually even kind of protect me a little bit, you know, even though I don't feel I need it because I'm committed to this and I'm not going to do it. But there are always people who want want to see if they can be the one to get you to eat a piece of bread. But anyway, so I don't remember where we were at before I started talking about bread.
It's okay. Let's keep talking about bread. They'll magically put more pounds.
Can you go out and get me some bread, please?
This is a good point to pause. I was about ready to pause.
Okay.
I'll take a break and I'll be right back. Okay, so you might have noticed because of lighting, we're on a little bit of a break. We just got back. And basically what we're going to try to do, please bear with us, is pull a lot of the information and what we've been talking about together into a little bit of a format so you can kind of see the steps of what happened through kind of a gigantic health or medical crisis, both of them, and then how that has like moved into a healthy aspect of life and just basically a new beginning. Moving on to David. Hello.
Hello. Okay, so I had a heart attack. So I was in the hospital. I was there for 5 days. To give you some idea of what happened, there is a test called a troponin that they test to see if you had a heart attack or not. It's an enzyme that's released when you have heart damage. My troponin entering the hospital was 12. Anything above 10 is classified as a major heart attack. My A1C, which is a diabetes reading, was 12 at that time. So the interesting thing is, after 5 days in the hospital on a troponin of 12, I have no major damage to my heart. How does that happen? It doesn't happen through the medical industry. That happens through energy healing. When I contacted Amber, she began using energy healing on me, and even from that time at a distance, and also when she stayed with me for a week helping me out, she was continuing to use energy healing on me. That's how you have a major heart attack without permanent heart damage.
Which is not something we want to do.
Correct. Energy healing is a very interesting process. It comes from working with your guides. But let me backtrack a little bit. Another important part is diet and exercise. And in fact, this occurred with me, reform of diet and exercise, before I actually started working with my guides. You can't just jump into everything all at once. Mm-hmm. There's some important things to recognize about changing your diet. Obviously, the best diet is a vegan diet. However, what you have to understand is that you have to have a good reason for changing your diet and for being a vegan vegetarian. It's more difficult. You can't just go out anywhere and eat. You have to make a lot of your own food. It's much healthier. But you better have a good reason for doing it. If you're only doing it because of another person, or if you're only doing it because it's cool, or because your friends are doing it, you're going to fail. I know from personal experience, I was a vegan before. When I no longer accepted the driving reason for why I was doing it, I failed. And everybody will fail if they don't have a good reason for doing it. That reason doesn't always have to be the same. My reason for being a vegan this time might have started out because of Amber. But if it continues because of Amber and that's the only reason I do it, that's not going to work. You have to have a good, solid reason for doing it which does not involve pleasing another person. You have
and
to please
sometimes
yourself.
That means you don't want to be sick.
Correct.
And I'm interrupting you, but I know
That's right.
You're going to say. Is the other reason, when we're looking at a good diet, we're also looking at the entire balance of the world. Like, if you've watched any of my other videos, it's like when you take care of yourself, you take care of the world. And right now with our population density and all that sort of stuff, so I'm not going to go into that too much right now. But you're making decisions based on your future, your children's future, your niecelings' future, you know, all those other futures that are out there. And so you're not being so selfish and self-centered in the way that some people are. You're really taking care of yourself, and then it takes care of everybody else too. And that's the way that works really well. And back to you.
So that's the reason why you have to have a good reason, because sometimes, every now and then, you're going to fail, and you have to have something that brings you back when you fail. This is also where it ties in with working with your guides. Usually you're going to reform your diet before you really start working with your guides, but they're a very important part of this. You need to check with your guides before you do anything, including the things that you eat. But it's important to know that the guides don't do things for you. They help you out, they give you information, they will support you, but they don't do things for you. Working with your guides on diet is not going to help if you're still eating Twinkies. You have to reform that diet. Also, there are things that guides don't do for you. Getting a little off the subject of diet, but for instance, if you're married and you're having problems with your spouse, the guides are not going to cure that for you. That's up to you to do. You know, they will give you help, they will support you, they will you know, give you advice, but they're not going to solve your everyday problems for you. They're not going to make you healthy if you're still eating Twinkies. So diet and exercise are very important, but there has to be a good reason for it, not just I decide tomorrow that I'm going to reform my diet.
Right. Can we talk about that a little bit?
Sure.
I want to talk about the idea of knowledge, because there's a certain basic knowledge that humans work with as they start working with their guides. And quite often, you know, I talk about deductive reasoning, which is really important, but a lot of people are really bad at it and they don't even know what that means. It's confusing. If you look it up, it's actually kind of confusing. But just think of that really famous writer. What's his name? You know it? Oh, Watson. You know?
Hmm? I don't know what she's talking about.
You don't know!
I'm sure as soon as she says it, I'm going to go, oh yeah, that one! Did we talk about memory before?
Everybody else gets it, it's okay. But basically, it's deducing information. It's like, okay, if this isn't working, then how about this one, how about that one? And when you start working with your guides and you're just getting yes and no's from them, you have to really use deductive reasoning to figure out which one's actually going to work the best. And this is really, really important, because when we're working with diet again, I'm going to focus on diet again, if they say, oh yeah, we really would like you to get a cookbook, and this one's yes, it's a good yes, right? But then you're looking through it, and you need to consistently work with your guides to figure out that there might be something wrong with one of those things for you, for your personal body. And that as you're going through the cookbook, you need to realize that there's things you could, you know, expand upon and do better on. And so it's just a process. I'm not going to say you're failing at anything, but you'll start learning through this process of how to go with your guide's influence, their suggestions, but then also understand that just because they say, yes, this cookbook, it doesn't mean that everything in that cookbook is going to be good for you. And if they just say, go to this professional, yeah, we're good with you going to that professional for help, it doesn't mean that they're going to be good with every single bit of advice or prescriptions or yada, yada, yada that particular professional would give to you. So working with your guides is really important because, well, basically, they know all the knowledge before anything was ever an idea of knowledge even. And they know your body type. They know everything that you need. And if you're going to embrace the idea of true health, body, mind, and spirit, you really need to learn to work with them and also understand that just because they say one thing's good once, or okay at a time. So I'm going to give you a really crazy example, and you're going to go, oh, well, that seems like really awful and unhealthy, but I get it. Okay, so let's say you're out in the middle of the night. Maybe your car broke down. Okay, I'm just giving you this like crazy idea. And you had to walk to a convenience station and you're starving, okay? And for that night, they say, oh, it's okay to have one of these energy drinks. That doesn't mean that every day you should have the energy drink, okay? So some people actually take that as always is okay, but mostly it's them lying to themselves about that I wasn't just in a bad situation and that energy drink was okay for me. So this is how we get caught up in this lie, that we lie to ourselves all the time. So we just have to try to balance things out and work through it, and then we'll do okay. And back to David.
Another point on that same subject that Amber was talking about is one of the reasons why it's so important to check things with your guides is because what the guides say is good for Amber may not be what's good for me. Mm-hmm. There are some givens. A vegan vegetarian diet is always going to be good for everybody. But for instance, just to take a silly example, Amber, rice may be good for her. For me, rice may cause problems. This is why it's important that you go to your guides and not to another person. It's very tempting just to ask somebody who's very experienced in this, what should I eat? Well, just because they say you should eat something doesn't mean that that's what you should eat. The guides have been around for a long, long time. They know more about health and all of this stuff than any number of humans together do. Get your advice from them.
And a pause.
Lost my train of
thought. No, that's perfect.
Another important part of your recovery is yoga. Oh yeah, I know everybody talks about yoga nowadays. And,
yeah, we do this.
And everybody thinks it's silly and all of that.
Or they
stuff.
Think it's amazing.
Yeah. Let me tell you, I started in on yoga. It took some convincing, but when I started taking it, it is wonderful. I mean, the way that you feel after you do it, the things that you can do after you've been doing yoga for a while, I mean, it changes your whole body composition. That's the wrong word, but it changes how you do things.
I'll just interject a little bit if that's
sure.
Okay. Well, for one, recovering from what David went through, your balance, well, wasn't very good before. And then it gets a little worse, like, you know, recovering from the massive heart attack and everything that goes along with that. And so it helps you start regaining your balance, for one. All those little parts that always ache and hurt at you start depleting. And I don't know, don't you just pay better attention to your body?
Yeah, you pay better attention to your body, you understand things that you feel better, you can take care of things before they become a serious problem. It just helps you put yourself in balance with yourself so that you're more perceptive of your body and what it needs and what's going on with it.
And that also helps you work better with your guides. If you're not paying attention to your body and being perceptive of everything that goes on, it's harder for you to work with your guides because they're there in this medium that's between what you believe is reality and this other ethereal world. And so when you start paying attention to who you are and how you feel, it's easier for you to connect with them.
And the other thing yoga will do, which kind of moves us into the next subject, is that it takes care of problems you have, pain, stiffness, joints, things like that, that most people rely on the medical industry to take care of, medications, things like that. You are much better off, and it's a necessity if you want to be a healthy person, to learn to do those things without medication and, more importantly, without relying on the medical industry. Am I saying that there will never be a time when you will need the medical industry? No. If you're in a car accident, you're probably going to need to go to the hospital. But there are a lot of things that people nowadays use the medical industry for that either you wait 4 days and it's gone, or you take care of your body and it doesn't happen to start with, or it disappears quickly. You know, I had pains in my knees, joints, and knees, hips, and shoulders due to the diabetes. I don't have those now. Partially because my diet's better, partially because yoga, but not at all because I'm taking medication. I don't do that, whereas I did at one time.
But actually, medication quite often exasperates conditions and makes them worse, which obviously you've heard that on TV, right? All the small print, the really fast talking. Yeah, that stuff. And you try to ignore that because you just want a quick fix, right? But for the most part, you don't need the medication for one, quite often. You just need to change your lifestyle. And number two, when you take the medication, it makes other things worse or it creates other issues. So we just have to like move things back into reality. And the other thing David just mentioned just a little bit earlier was that a lot of times people go to the medical industry for things that go away or that are, you know, you could just change your lifestyle a little bit, that sort of thing. This is really important to know because I think we've lost, I don't think, not only have we lost, but a lot of it wasn't even known by the human standards of ways to take care of those things in the first place. You know, we've been indoctrinated with the idea that medicine fixes everything. I mean, and as far as David's heart attack, I mentioned earlier that I did bring in some herbals for him because it was necessary at the time. He was in a very bad state when we got him home. And so, and I say wait because I'm going to work with my guides. But that was only for a little while. I love herbals, but mostly your food is your medicine. Herbals are there also just to support you through something, but they have way less side effects. And they're to help you move into another space. And so for the most part, what you want to do is body, mind, spirit, yoga, meditation, working with your guides, really good healthy food with herbs in your food. We don't want bland food, we want healthy herbals in our food. And then only use like concentrated herbals for emergencies or when your body falls out of balance. That's what we're looking for. For the most part, we're looking for just a good healthy lifestyle for the most part. And then only using herbals when you need to, and only using the medical industry when you really, really need to, which could come in certain circumstances. For one, you might be out of country and it's hard to find your herbals, you don't know what to do. The other thing, you just haven't resourced well enough. Like I was talking about earlier that I tried to give David and clients a system, a web system of people that they can go to even if I'm not available, and then of course their guides, so they can have a little pharmaceutical area. I know I'm not supposed to use that word, I don't care. A little mini herbal pharmaceutical so that they can take care of most of the issues on their own. And back to David. I hope. Pause. Okay.
Pausing because I'm going to say something here that I suspect you want to keep in, but I want to give you the option of cutting it out if you don't want. Okay, unpause. What's really important with this way of healing is the triple part of mind, body, spirit. That's how it works with your guides. That's how it works in this process. So recently, the medical industry has started using the term mind, body, spirit. In reality, they probably ought to be using the terms sickness, medicine, and money. They have nothing to do with mind, body, and spirit. There are many things that the medical industry could do to make people healthier, and they don't, because they're really not interested in that. So, a point that Amber made earlier, just because your guides made direct you to a professional or direct you to a book does not mean that everything about that is correct. You have to check each individual thing.
Mm-hmm. That's a big one.
I think the next step, if I haven't forgotten anything here, is meditation. Meditation is very important. It helps you to communicate with your guides. It helps you to get information from your guides. It connects you with your guides. Working with your guides and medication, both of those require practice. It's something that you have to do quite frequently so that you can become experienced at it and become good at it. So the guides can help you with this. They can teach you how to meditate. There are good books out there that can also kind of get you going on the process. I know for me it was kind of a daunting thing of meditation. What does that mean?
Me too.
But it's easier than you think it is. The important thing is don't go in with preconceived ideas. When I finally got the idea of meditation, it was because I was looking in the wrong place for the wrong thing. The whole thing that makes meditation and working with your guides work is that you keep your mind open so that you're willing and able to accept ideas that come in.
We're back.
Yeah, we're back. So another important part of this process is to begin the process of having a better self-image, of being more confident in your abilities, of understanding what you can do, what you can't do. All humans nowadays, almost all of them, probably all of them, have a lot of doubt all the time. This is part of being a human. And when that doubt gets out of hand, when you don't have a good self-image, when you don't have a good idea of your abilities, then all you have left is doubt. And that's not a pretty picture. Take it from me. That's not a pretty picture. So you need to develop that self-image, that confidence in your abilities, maybe even finding out what your abilities are. A lot of people don't know.
Right, that's true. And you can't fake it. You can't say, I'm unhealthy, but I still love myself. Okay, yes, you should still love yourself, but it means you're striving to do something to make yourself better. But if you're just going to stay in the same hole, the same darkness, and then just pretend to tell yourself that you love yourself, that's not okay. That's how people, I don't want to go there necessarily, but I'm going to say it, that's how people commit suicide, is when they still, they keep lying to themselves enough, and then all of a sudden everything breaks down, and they realize they don't really love themselves. They've just been lying to themselves and lying to other people. So what you need to do is like pull all this stuff together, body, mind, spirit, and finding out, again, what your attributes are is really important. And if you can at least find a few of them and start, and what your, kind of positive energies are, and pulling those together, and this is sort of not what you're going to say. I think I might be bringing this off in a different direction.
Okay.
But it's really important when you find those, start grasping at those, start building those, and then other stuff will come together. So if it's your emotional space, if your physical space, which all tie in together, but at least if you can find something that you can do. If it's fixing your diet, pull to that. If it's working with some of your mental stuff and pulling into that, then your diet will come. Or if you do your diet, then your mental space will come. But you need to, if you can start pulling on something that you can do, things will pull themselves together.
And actually that ties in pretty good with what I was going to say. Because improving your self-image, being confident or even learning about your abilities, those have to come from inside and from the guides. They can't come from somebody else. If you are getting your enhanced self-image and your idea of your attributes and your abilities from, say, your wife, and she's building you up, and then one day she comes in and calls you a total idiot and just rails on you, all of that has been destroyed.
Mm-hmm.
you know, you're back to square one because you didn't build it up yourself. You let somebody else build it up. So this is something you have to do on your own with your guides. You have to learn these things. You have to enhance your self-image. If you've enhanced your own self-image and have a good idea of what your abilities are, nobody can take that away from you. It doesn't matter how nasty they get. You know, you can lose your best friend, but that's not going to take that away if you built it up yourself and you've internalized it.
Mm-hmm. That's really important, especially because all of us go through strife at work, through relationships, through anything like that. Mm-hmm. But you have to own yourself in a really positive, loving way. And knowing what your flaws are, also a really big one. You know what your flaws are. Know what they are and own those. And so you're not lying to yourself, and then you're a whole person then. If you're going to lie to yourself and you say, okay, these are all my positive attributes, but then forget about all those negative ones that you have, or possible negative ones, sometimes they can be used for good or evil, right? Same with the positive ones. Sometimes, you know, you can overuse those in one way or the other. But if you can kind of pull those together, you're a really whole person. But it does take work, and it does take the body, mind, spirit attribute to like pull this all together.
And don't lie to yourself about your weaknesses. Those weaknesses are what the guides are here for, mm-hmm. to help you with, mm-hmm. and to improve. If you don't recognize them, they can't help you with them. So what that is a road to downfall. So it's a two-way street. You have to be aware and accept your abilities and your strengths, but you also have to be aware but not accept your deficiencies, you know, your, mm-hmm. your weaknesses. Those are the ones you have to work on. So, you know, it's very important to be perfectly honest with yourself. Sometimes that honesty comes through a very strong person that you know.
Don't talk to me like that. What?
A very pushy, bossy person who may tie you down and force things down your throat figuratively of what, you know, you need to know about yourself. Sometimes it can come from some interesting things like readings and stuff like that.
Let's put it this way. I'm a very, very honest person. If you want to do this work, you got to do the work. I mean, if you don't want to do the work, go see somebody else. That's the way I am, right? Mm-hmm. Pretty much like that.
Mm-hmm.
The other thing that I will say, and I'm not sure this is going to make any of this on YouTube, but I would like love to take a lot of people that I care about or love. Actually, I love everybody, so they're sad. But if I could just put them in a holistic area where I could completely control everything and they could only eat this and only do this and then do that and make them just complete, you know what? The minute I let them loose, they wouldn't be complete anymore. And plus, they might resent what I was doing in the first place. So the bottom line is you have to own what you're doing. So just like we were talking about, we have to own our flaws, own our strengths, and we have to own our changes in our lives. Otherwise, we won't keep them for ourselves. We'll let them go.
But that doesn't mean that there can't be people that are important in your life that help you with this.
Right.
I mean, you can have somebody, a energy healer like Amber or somebody else in your life that helps you through the rough places and helps you work this stuff out.
And it's good to have a multiple task force.
But they can't give you all the answers. Mm-hmm. They can't do things for you. When it comes down to the end of the day, when it's time to make a change, they can't do it for you.
And I can't put you in a wonderful little zone and make you do
Although we need to work on that. It'd be so much easier if you could do these things for me.
I know.
I'll pay you a dollar.
A dollar? A dollar a day? Maybe for a dollar a day.
So anyway, it's very important to understand these things. Don't lie to yourself. You know, you shouldn't lie to other people either, but especially don't lie to yourself.
It starts with yourself and then it sort of cascades over.
Hmm.
Are we done?
The only other things I would say is it's also kind of important to get out there and make social contact with people. If you're going home every night and sitting by yourself and watching TV, this whole process is not going to work. Other than the fact that you're not exercising and you're probably eating potato chips while you're watching TV. But, you know, you have to have friends, and friends that are going to support you in what you're doing. Not the same old people that were giving you, you know, the sausage pizza that made you have the heart attack to start with. You have to have people around you. You have to get out there. Sure, there's going to be some people that you love more than other people. But they're not going to be around every day. And when they're not around, you have to continue with your healthy life, which in most cases doesn't mean sitting at home alone. Now, time alone is also important. That's when you meditate and do things like that. But, and again, I say this from personal experience because, you know, I'm working on this, but I don't have a lot of friends. I don't have a lot of people that I'm really close to. And so that's something that I'm working on that is all part of this process. So none of this happens overnight. It's a continuing process that you take step by step. I won't put myself through the torture of doing this, but Amber could probably tell you a whole list of things that she's told me at one time or another that I should do that I've forgotten.
I won't. It's okay. It's just my job.
And it's not that I disagreed with him or didn't believe him. It's just that there are so many things to work on that some of them fall through the cracks.
Right.
So you have to constantly be reevaluating your process.
Yes, that's good. Reevaluate your own process all the time. Can I say it one more time? Reevaluate.
Can you?
It's a good idea. Like, just oversee yourself. That's what you should be doing. You should be taking care of yourself all the time, and that's what we don't do.
So, we've covered a lot of stuff here. Am I completely back on the path of total health? No. I still have work to do.
I'm going to say yes, he's on the path of total health. It's just not there yet.
Okay, that's what I meant. I meant at the end.
We have to be patient with ourselves. I mean, if you actually go back and listen to all our babbling about the timeline of everything of his sickness and how everything has went forward, he's doing awesome. This is not even a year yet that he started a process after a massive heart attack. And what, we're down to like a little tiny bit of insulin sometimes. So this is good. This is what we're looking for. I talk to a lot of people about building blocks, and even though I explained it a million times, they don't really understand, but we have to have building blocks, and the building blocks are food. And for people that are really, really sick, who have been sick for a long time, and for some strange reason, he was only on herbals for a little while. But there's other people that have been sick for a really long time, and we put them right on herbals if they accept them, and some of them won't, because they don't understand the idea of building blocks and what your body needs to actually heal. But you're on the path. It's already happened, and it's going to continue to happen.
I guess if I have a final thing to say, it would be don't get discouraged.
That's a good idea.
The guides are there to help you. They are much nicer than I am. You know, if I were dealing with me, I probably would have given up on me a long time ago. They don't. As long as you're still trying and listening, they are still there and they are still helping. They are, one guide probably has more knowledge than the entire human population together. They know what they're doing, they know how to help you, they know how to take care of these things. The problem is, we don't know how to listen.
Right.
And we don't know how to turn control over to someone else to a certain extent.
Think of it as Google again. If you're gonna, everybody goes to Google, but nobody will go to a much more intelligent source. And what your guides do is they can tap into the knowledge of everything. So it's like universal Google. And so you're getting that you can get the knowledge of everything if you're capable of allowing that and tapping into that. So basically, instead of wires and cords, we're doing it in a different way.
And just, you know, make sure that the person you're working with, you know, picking an energy healer is like picking a physician.
It's true. So
you have to get the right one, and it has to work. Amber is wonderful. Love her dearly. She helps me in many ways, and then she kicks my ass when I need it. So this is what you need to do, is you need to get somebody that you can work with.
And you can only do that through your guides. Because again, I mean, I might not be the right person for you right now. Sometimes you need something a little more fluffy. I'm not fluffy. I'm like, get your job done and do this. You know, like, sit down, do this. I'm for practicalities. For absolute knowledge, along with nuances and meditation, but I want you to work. Otherwise, you know, sometimes your guides will be like, not right now. Why don't you go do this, go research this, and then maybe sometime, you know, that'll work. So listen to your guides. If you have the ability to, do that, and then you can go from there.
And you know, even as an energy healer, you have to listen to your guides. I mean, this didn't
That's the only way you are an energy healer.
This didn't come up before, but Amber has told me before that before I had my heart attack, the guides told her, leave me alone. Don't try to work with him because he's not ready yet. Mm-hmm. And then when I had my heart attack, they said, okay, now you can do it. So, you know, it works both ways. Timing is all important. Mm. Timing is the most critical thing. If the time is not right, that doesn't mean that you can't help that person. It just means that maybe you'll help them later. Just like from the person's point of view, you know, 2 years ago, the time was not right for me to do this stuff. Mm-hmm. A year ago, laying in the hospital bed, the time became right. Mm-hmm. So, you know, timing is everything. I hope you've gotten something out of our babbling.
Me too. Yeah, I guess since you touched on it a little bit, I'll touch on it a little bit too. Which is in some of my tutorials. Some of them are on YouTube, some of them aren't. But, and some of them are locked, so I only give them to some people. But if you're going to be an energy healer, if you're, that's what you think you're going to do, and body, mind, spirit is important, because if you just think you're just going to do the energy, that's only part of it, because the energy flows into testing for food, it flows into testing for this, it flows into the mind, so that's why it's body, mind, spirit. But as a healer, you have to be really careful with yourself, because you can't just be walking around feeling everybody else's energy and like tapping into everybody all the time, because you're going to get sick. So you have to learn how to deal with all that stuff, which, again, like my guides, leave him alone. He wasn't ready, you know? And it's still a gambling process because he's a human being, and they make decisions kind of, like, really quick and wonky on occasions. But the bottom line...
Yeah, because I really want to go back to a bad heart.
But no, beforehand.
Hospital was so much
fun.
I don't want to go back there.
Some people like that. They just keep doing the same thing. They keep going back.
The food is delicious.
And they love to talk about it. It's so much fun to talk about your ailments. Isn't that fun?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, we just did that for hours.
We just spent an hour doing that.
Okay, we're done. We're getting goofy. We're done. We can't do this anymore.
Okay, well, thanks for listening.
Bye.
Bye.